Equality in society. In this response, you find you cannot bring prosperity by discouraging thriftiness. You cannot help small men by tearing down big men. You cannot strengthen the weak by weakening the strong. You cannot lift the wage earner by pulling down the wage payer. You cannot help the poor man by destroying the rich. You cannot keep out of trouble by so ending more than... You cannot keep out of trouble by so ending more of your income. You cannot further brotherhood of men by inciting class hatred. You cannot establish security on borrowed money. And you cannot build character and courage by ranking away man's initiative and independence. We must therefore ask ourselves some crucial questions. Where, when, and how did the rain start beating us? We have to address the situation and address it really fast. God has given us a clear mandate right from the beginning, and therefore we read our scripture reading this morning from Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 through to 28. The Bible says that God said, "Let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." Verse 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him, male and female he created them. Verse 28. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and every living thing that moves in the earth." So, what is mandate? You know, some words are general words that we use every day, but from just a simple definition from the dictionary, a mandate is an official order or commission to do something. It can also be described as a commission by which a party is entrusted to perform a service. A mandate could also be a written authorization enabling somebody to carry out certain transactions. It also means the authority to carry out a policy. So right from the beginning, you see God giving man a very clear mandate, as we have just read. The Bible says the man was given the authority to have dominion over the sea, the air, the earth, and all creeping things. Secondly, God gives him this mandate and tells him, "Be fruitful." Number three, he tells him, "Multiply." Number four, he says, "Fill the earth." And number five, he tells him, "Subdue." The reality we have is man was made to conquer. That's why he gives you the dominion, to rule, and to be a giant. But the reality is also that the giant is asleep. You cannot go ahead by stepping on others. The giant is not determined by muscles, stature, or might. But being a giant is about character, integrity, nature, and responsibility. Last year, I was doing a series. This topic is not a topic we can finish on a morning. I ran a series for about a whole year on awakening the giant. And this is what I wrote down. A sleeping giant is no better than a dwarf. A sleeping or fallen giant cannot do exploits. Isaiah the prophet, speaking to the children of Israel and talking about irresponsible leaders, he says in Isaiah 56 verse 10, his watchmen are blind. They are all ignorant. They are all dumb dogs. They cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. We must awaken the giant. Sons are looking for giants in their fathers. Daughters are craving for giants in their men. Real women want giants. Giants ought to awaken. But as the picture might look so grim and might look so disturbing, let's just look at what God says in that portion of scripture and bring context to what we are saying. The Bible says that man and that this giant was made in the image of God and his likeness. So man is a prototype of God. He's a God. God made him in his image and his likeness. But the also truth here is, man was made to be fruitful. Fruitfulness. And bring out increase. Depending on the blessing that God has given him. We cannot be fruitful without God. Because God himself is a fruitful God. And God desires that every man must be fruitful and bring increase. But it also, the fact of dominion. God gave to man and made him to have dominion over inferior creatures, over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air. So when man reduces himself to behave like an animal, he has actually reduced himself to the very lowest, because man is supposed to have dominion over animals. When people behave, you know, men behave like animals, they've actually degraded themselves to the level of the creatures that they're supposed to have dominion over. Though man provides for either, he has power over both the animal and the creature that move him. But God does not give this dominion to oppress, but to give care within certain reach. But also man was given dominion so that he could put a system of honor and that he might bring glory to his maker. But we see as a man begins to fall in the Garden of Eden, he loses dominion because God casts him out of the garden. And that is where our challenge begins from. So that what we see as a manifestation of men getting away from the blueprint that God has given was a beginning of the fall. It began at the fall when man disregarded the rules that God had given him in the Garden of Eden and given him a certain mandate. Some simple people have reduced the fall of man by eating a fruit to mean sex. That is the simplest form of foolishness. Because if God wanted to say man fell because of sex, it would have simply been written as such. But that is a debate for another day. When we see a man or the giant falling asleep, it basically means his focus, his vision is blurred. He can no longer see. Everything is out of focus. We also see the giant losing image, and that's what we have just read. But you might be asking and sitting there and wondering, okay, where are you going with all these many stories? How then do we get to awaken the giant? The prophet Joel in chapter 3 of the book of Joel, verse 9 through to 12, he says, proclaim this among the nations. Prepare for war. Wake up the mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come out. Beat out your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. I happen to be in a position where I interview people for employment quite often. Or sometimes I'm sitting on a board and I'm doing certain things. And one of the things that has intrigued me over a period of time is the loss of purpose that young men have. I remember a situation not too long ago, we had interviews for a marketing manager, and the criteria was well set out, and people applied, and we zeroed down to about 5 candidates that we were now interviewing for the final position. They came in, there were about 3 ladies and 2 gentlemen. They came in, the ladies, very strong, very upright, very articulate, giving the reasons why you should hire them. Then came this young man who I thought, by looking at the credentials and what he had done, he had studied abroad, he had good papers, he had good, everything looked very good. We asked him one question and he started crying. And that left me wondering, what did we ask that was so difficult that the man began to cry? Came in the other man, and he fidgeted around, he was not confident, he was so nervous, and almost said nothing. Remember, these were people who were qualified, they had master's degrees, they had studied in the best of schools that could be, and they were looking for a job. But that sent me on a journey to search and to think. I'm also a father of boys, so I wanted to know what is going on. And I realized there's a problem. And the problem is not in the education. The problem is not because women have been empowered. The problem, sometimes men have learned to know their purpose. They don't know why God created them. They do not understand why what they do and why they do what they do. They do not have a vision. They do not have a mission. But when we're looking at all these things, we can blame all the men. And even this morning, we can come here and beat ourselves as men and say, no, men have lost their mandate. Men are not where they're supposed to be. Fathers are not doing. That does not solve the problem. We must begin to have some conversations and ask ourselves critical questions and begin to say, how do we change this narrative? How do we move this and begin to have men of substance? I have never known one woman who wants to have a house husband. You know what house husbands are? Where the wife goes to work, if they are lucky to have a car, the wife, the husband will drive the wife to work, then he'll come home, wash dishes and sleep. I don't know how many women like this kind of husbands. And I can tell you most of these women here, especially those who've gone to school, none of them wants that kind of husband. Men who are sitting in the house from morning to evening because they do not go on, do not want to exert themselves and look for something. What is education for if you can only look for a white collar job? Think about that old woman who has 1,000 shillings. Every morning she rises up from Kibera, goes to Marigiti to buy bananas with 1,000 shillings. Takes those bananas, goes and sits at a roadside and sells them and translates her 1,000 shillings to 3,000 shillings. Pays some money for food. Pays some money to her rent. Pays some money to buy paraffin. And she continues with the process the following day. A child goes to school, maybe one of you who is seated here. That woman and the man seated in the house, the first class or second class honors, who is more educated? Let's think about that. The book of Ecclesiastes 10:10 says, if the axe is dull and does not sharpen the edge, then he must use more strength, but wisdom brings success. Man is an instrument in God's hand, and you cannot do battle for the family, for the church, and for the nation if you are asleep. Because a sharp axe will increase efficiency. A sharp axe is more incisive. A sharp axe is more defined. A sharp axe will be better at penetration. And then a sharp axe creates more intensity. Therefore, we are asking men, if they have to understand their mandate, the giant must be sharp to operate in these three areas. Number one is purpose. Because purpose defines the age. Number two, they must operate with a vision. Because vision sharpens the age. And number three, they must have a mission. Mission directs the edge. I'm using the analogy of an axe, and that brings out those three things. So that if men have to be men who will take up their mandate today, we are now in a political dispensation. And you hear men standing up on podiums, many of them lying to people, telling them things and saying, we want to be your leaders, but everything they're spewing out are total lies. They have deceived themselves and are even deceiving those that want them to elect. Sometimes I've been tricked. I've been to university also. Young men who have the right mind, who are doing serious courses, who want to be change agents in society, who want to be prosperous men, will take a stone and stone an innocent passerby who has no idea why the electricity was switched off. Those are sleeping giants, people who do not understand their mandate. Why would you vent your anger on the wrong person? If your lecturer did not turn up, look for your lecturer. Don't go look for an innocent mother or father of somebody who has no idea about your lecturer. I know I might be unsafe by the time I leave here. But God help me. Therefore, we must have the right perception and the right perspective as we do this thing. The Bible tells us in Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Understanding your purpose. Why are you on earth? Why are you in campus at this time? Because you're in campus for a reason and for a season. Even if you do 5-10 degrees, a time comes that you must exit campus. I knew a man who had 5 PhDs. But a time came he had to exit university, isn't it? Because the Bible says, even to learning, there's no end. You can learn as much as you want, but you can continue and continue. But a time comes that you must exercise what you have. Men cannot continue to live half lives and do things in half measure. They ought to operate in their full mandate. You know, a part-time Christian cannot defeat a full-time devil. So if you're always half-half, nusu-nusu, you know those nusu-nusu Christians? There's no way you will defeat a full-time devil. You must operate in your full mandate. If you're going to make a difference in character, in integrity, you must operate in your full mandate. We ought to be like David of old, who cried out in Psalm 80 verse 19 and said, "Restore us, O God of hosts, cause your face to shine, and we shall be saved." Therefore, what am I saying as I bring this message to a close? God is willing us to, number one, to return to Him, to who Him Himself is the author, who has given us the mandate, the blueprint. And He says, number one, return to God, and He will return to you. According to Zechariah 1:3, He says, "Therefore say to them, thus says the Lord of hosts, return to me, declares the Lord of hosts, that I may return to you, says the Lord of hosts." The second thing is, even when we are scattered, we have gone so far from God and forgotten the mandate. Whatever the distraction, whether because you think successful people are not, cannot be Christians, I can tell you I have met many successful people. Nehemiah says in Nehemiah 1:9, that if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, those of you who have been scattered were in the most remote part of the heavens, I will gather them from there and I will bring them to the place where I have chosen to cause my name to dwell. It does not matter how far you have gone. God is saying, you can come back. And then number three, even when we have sinned and walked away from God, God is merciful. Hosea 14, verse 1 says, "Return, O Israel, to the Lord your God, for you have stumbled because of your iniquity." Sin separates us from God. Sin alienates us from our purpose. And sin misplaces us from our mandate. When we walk in sin, we are separated from God, the author of the blueprint and the mandate is given to have dominion. So when we begin to sin, we are separated from God. Secondly, it removes us from the purpose that God created you. If God wanted you just to be drinking all the time, why didn't He just create alcohol? Why did He create you? Find your purpose. Sin displaces us from our mandate. That's why a full-grown man will take a young girl of 9 years and sleep with her, saying it will cure him of HIV/AIDS. Why? Because he's misplaced. He does not know his mandate at all. But there are three remedies to this. The book of Joel tells us in Joel chapter 2, verse 12 to 14. "Now therefore, says the Lord, turn to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. So rend your heart, not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for He is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, for He relents from doing harm. Who knows if He return and relent and leave a blessing behind Him, a grain offering, a drink offering, for the Lord is your God." Three things. Joel is saying, repent. Turn your heart to God. He says, turn to me with all your heart. Secondly, he says, rend your heart, not your garments. Because God is looking for your heart, not the things you do for God. Because sometimes we think serving God is more important than obeying God. So I am doing things for God. God is not interested in the things you are doing for Him. He says he can even stand storms to do things for him. God is interested in your heart. Then he says, return to me. He says he's a compassionate God, slow to anger, great of kindness. And he says, when we come to him, he will even turn everything around and leave you a blessing. Therefore, as we conclude and think about the mandate that God has given us, we must remember this thing. That God is the author of the mandate we have. And we operate within the framework of what God has given us. And if he is the author, I'm sure some of you are engineering students, when you have done your drawings, you want the contractor, whoever you've given that work to do, to follow every part you've given. You've said this should be at 3 inches. It must be 3 inches. Because you are the author of what you have given. And God has authored man. God has given man a mandate. And God has given the rules by which man should operate. But in our own fallen nature, we tend to wander away and begin to move in our own direction. And this morning, God is saying, it does not matter where you have been. You think you're the greatest sinner. Wait until you see the other sinner. But God is calling me and you to go back and realize what he has called us. To go back to the purpose he has made us. To sharpen our vision and think further than the little things we do here. For a few years, I also sat in a class as a student. But when you are there, you must have your eyes trained on why you are there, isn't it? And you finish. But that is just a phase in life. There's much more to that. Because some of you, the reality is, you will graduate from here and never have a job. That's the reality. Some of you will graduate from here and become prosperous people. That's the reality. Some of you will graduate from here and become great people. But some of you could graduate from here with honors and make a mess of your life and a great mess. And I've met many men who have messed up their lives. They've risen up in the ranks of society. They have made big money. Our country is in a mess. Why? Because men have lost mandate. Even if you have 10 cars, how many cars can you drive at any given time? Even if you have a 6-bedroom house, you can only sleep in one room at one time. I met a man who wanted to counsel me. He's a doctor, his wife is a doctor. His 2 sons had gone to study abroad, and both of them were not coming back. And he told me, young man, listen to me carefully. Sometimes the things we are striving for make no sense. Today, I have a big house, an 8-bedroom house. And every time I leave my wife there, I'm so fearful. Actually, my wife has enjoyed more than I do. Because when I come back at 10 from the hospital rounds, I am tired. And I go straight to the table. Sometimes I'm going to eat, I go straight to bed and sleep. And he says this can go on for months. I don't even know how some rooms look after 2 years. But when he was beginning, he thought, this is how life is enjoyed. The reality is, those things, a time comes, they don't make sense. Therefore, my brethren, I want to encourage you this morning. While we are sitting here, let's remember the mandate we have. We can blame women, we can do everything. But God gives us this one chance to return to him, who is the author, and ask him, how ought I to live? How ought I to do things that I may make sense of my life? I want us to all be upstanding. I want us to take time and just close your eyes. I've not come with a nice fancy message. I've not come sweating on the pulpit here to impress you. I've just come to send you some few truths. I want all of us to close our eyes and take a moment of reflection. moment of reality. Paul says, I did not come to you with eloquence. So I'm not coming to you with eloquence, but just telling you as it is. But even as I say as it is, I'm saying this from a compassionate heart. That if the men of our day are going to be men that women will celebrate, if they're going to be men society will espouse, they're going to be men people will want to look up to, they're going to be men who understand they are giants and not dwarfs, must go back to where God has called them.